I'm Dr. Colin Campbell, and this is a Meter Chalk Talk. In other Chalk Talks, we've sat down and talked about how to calculate things like water vapor pressure. But we haven't done anything with that, and today we're going to try to take that one step further. I put together an equation here that says that the flux of something we're interested in is equal to the ability of that to move, we call that G, times the concentration difference. So today we're going to try to use this equation, this flux equation we often call it, to try to estimate the movement of mass like CO2 or water vapor in air. Now we're not going to get all the way to the end of this problem, that'll be in another Chalk Talk, but we're going to start it. First, let's talk about how we calculate a concentration. The concentration is simply equal to the moles of gas J that we're interested in divided by the moles of air. And we could stop there if we knew how to use a mole with respect to water vapor, but we don't. Water vapor is usually measured in things like relative humidity or vapor pressure, and that's obviously something we can't use right now. So we've got to use the ideal gas law to sort this all out. So let's see what happens there. The ideal gas law says that the pressure of gas J times the volume is equal to the moles of gas J times R times T, where J is the gas of interest, P sub J is the partial pressure, of gas J in air. V is just the volume. N, J is the moles of gas J. R is the universal gas constant. Joules per mole Kelvin, and T is the Kelvin temperature. So with this universal gas constant, we do have the moles and the partial pressure of gas J, or what we would sometimes call the vapor pressure if we were dealing with water vapor, right in this equation. So we can actually rearrange this equation effectively to give us the answer we need. We can also say that the pressure of air is equal to the same thing. Pressure of air times the volume is equal to the moles of air times R times T, where we define PA as the pressure of the air. This is a value we're pretty familiar with. At sea level, for example, the pressure of the air is 101.3 kilopascals. With these two equations, we can combine them together to actually answer the question of the concentration. Having these equations in this form, we can actually rearrange them in terms of moles. So, for example, the moles of gas J would be equal to the pressure or partial pressure of gas J times the volume divided by RT, while the moles of air would be just the pressure of the air times the volume divided by R and T. Now, if we look above, the concentration is just the moles of gas J divided by the moles of air. If we combine these two, we have the concentration is the moles of gas J divided by the moles of air, and now pressure of gas J times the volume divided by RT over the pressure of air times volume divided by RT. And if you look, all these nicely cancel out in the equation, and we get something we can now use, which is the partial pressure of gas J divided by the pressure of the air is equal to our concentration. Now again, looking back up here, we are one step closer to answering this question, what is our concentration, so that we can calculate a flux. But we've still got work to do. How do we calculate the pressure of the air? Luckily, there is a pretty easy equation to calculate air pressure. It says that 101.3 kilopascals, or the pressure at sea level, can be multiplied by the exponential of the altitude in meters of where we are divided by 8,200. So A, it's altitude in meters. And if we do this calculation, we have a pretty easy way to getting our air pressure. Now, one thing to note, air pressure goes up and down depending on the weather. And so we may calculate an air pressure for example, where we live, which is about 92.5 kilopascals, but that can go down to 91 and up to 92.5 maybe. I've seen it go all over the place within reason for the location you are. So this is a great rule of thumb, but be careful, it's not an absolute value. So what about calculating water vapor pressure? We learned about how to do that in another Chalk Talk, but here we want to take that one step further by calculating a concentration. But first of all, we need to know the partial pressure of water vapor. So are we ready now to calculate the concentration of something like water vapor in air? Well, let's look at that for a second. So the concentration of vapor in the air, it's equal to the partial pressure of gas J, this time water vapor, divided by the pressure of the air. Now, I just showed you how to calculate the pressure of the air. The partial pressure of water vapor in air, we usually describe with a symbol EA. So we just have EA over PA. Now, when we talked before, I did mention the partial pressure of water vapor being EA. But usually if we get data from a weather station, for example, we don't get vapor pressure. We usually get relative humidity. So what do we do to find that? Let's remember from our old Chalk Talk. From a former Chalk Talk, we see that the relative humidity, HR, is equal to the vapor pressure, EA, over the saturation vapor, ES, TA, where TA is the air temperature. Now we learned then how to calculate the saturation vapor pressure, and we learned how to calculate the vapor pressure from the relative humidity. If we just rearrange this equation, we can get the vapor pressure, EA, is equal to the relative humidity, HR, times the saturation vapor pressure at the air temperature. So let's do a little example to make sure we're following along. In our little example, let's say the air temperature was around 20 degrees Celsius. And the relative humidity that we're given from a weather station is around 25%, or 0.25. How would we calculate the saturation vapor pressure and eventually the concentration of water vapor in the air? Well, we'd first start with the equation I showed before. The vapor pressure, EA, is equal to the relative humidity times the saturation vapor pressure. Now, we have to use what's called Teton's formula that we talked about in that other Chalk Talk to get this value. That's pretty straightforward. The saturation vapor pressure at a temperature of 20 degrees is equal to 2.34 kilopascals. And since we know the relative humidity is 0.25, we can multiply by the saturation vapor pressure, 2.34 kilopascals, and we gotta get to water vapor pressure of, or partial pressure of 0.578 kilopascals. So how do we get that concentration? Well, we need to combine the vapor pressure, A, divided by the pressure of the air, PA. Now let's assume we're at sea level. We can do that calculation for anywhere, but since we're trying to do this as simply as possible, let's pretend that our air pressure was 101.3 kilopascals. The vapor pressure we just calculated was 0.578 kilopascals. And our concentration, and I should add a V there, the concentration of vapor in the air, therefore, is 0.00578. Oh, that looks like a small number. The units are moles per mole. Looks like those cancel, but moles of water vapor to moles of air. And usually we change this around, so we say that CV is equal to 5.78 millimoles per mole. And we don't have to write all those zeros. So that's how we calculate a concentration. We can do that for the source of interest, maybe inside a leaf, which is usually at saturation. We just need to know the temperature of the leaf. We can calculate how much water vapor is going to move if we know the conductance. And we'll talk about that another time. I want to show you one other thing though before we go. One other important thing we can do with the ideal gas law and understanding of density is be able to convert from our concentration or our partial pressures over to an actual mass. This is useful for trying to estimate water loss from leaves, for example. So how is that done? Well, if we describe density as a mass over a volume, we can talk also about a density in the air of any gas J. That's just the mass of gas J, a molar mass of gas J times the moles of that gas J divided by the volume, where M sub J is just the molar mass. You may be wondering, what is a molar mass? Those are pretty simple. For example, CO2 has a molar mass of 44 grams per mole. Water vapor has a molar mass of 18 grams per mole. Those are pretty simple and straightforward. And we're going to use those later. Now, we've been talking about moles all along, and not surprisingly, we're going to use the ideal gas law, and we're going to rearrange this density equation that we just wrote in terms of moles. So that says that the moles of gas J is equal to the density of gas J times the volume divided by the molar mass of gas J. And once we have that in terms of moles, we can stick it into the ideal gas law and rearrange things and be able to have a partial pressure of the gas we're interested in terms of density. So let's see how that's done. So the ideal gas law says the partial pressure of gas J times the volume equals the moles of gas J times RT. If we substitute now in for the moles, we get the partial pressure of gas J times the volume is equal to the density of gas J times the volume divided by the molar mass times R times T. Now we're going to cancel in that and take out the volume, cancel those on the either side, and we have the partial pressure of gas J is equal to the density of gas J times RT over MJ, the molar mass. Now, more typically, we have the partial pressure of the gas, like the partial pressure of water vapor that we just calculated a moment ago, EA. But this time, we're gonna rearrange this in terms of the density. That's usually where we're going. So the density of gas J is equal to the partial pressure of gas J times the molar mass of gas J divided by RT, okay? So that defines a relationship between the density and partial pressure, but how might this be useful to us? Now, it's not going to get us to a concentration to calculate flux, but it is going to help us once we have some of these numbers to go from a partial pressure, and if we know the volume, to get to a mass. And often a mass is something we're interested in. So let's try to do that. So let's try to answer a very simple question. How much CO2 is in a meter cube of air? Now, right now, the concentration of CO2 in the atmosphere is around 421 parts per million. When described like that, maybe that makes you nervous and say, I'm not sure even where to go with that. Well, actually, that's 0.000421 moles of CO2 per mole of air. Now, that sounds pretty familiar to the concentrations we were talking about, and in fact, that is a concentration of CO2. Now, how do we get from there to an actual mass? This is going to take a couple steps. But remember, the concentration of CO2 is just equal to the partial pressure of CO2 divided by the atmospheric pressure. So, if we were wanting to find the partial pressure of CO2, and again, that's what we are going to use to calculate the density, the partial pressure of CO2 is just equal to the air pressure, PA, times the concentration of CO2. Now, to make this problem easier on us, why don't we just call the pressure of the air 101.3? Now, I know that may not be the pressure of the air exactly where I'm sitting, but that'll help us work through the problem, and then you can adjust for where you are. I already showed you how to calculate the pressure of the air at any altitude. So, let's do this calculation. The partial pressure of CO2 is equal to 101.3 kilopascals times this 0.000421 moles per mole. I'm running out of space there. The calculation looks like this. If we put it into the calculator, that is 42.6 pascals. So notice I cut out the kilopascals just down to pascals because the number was very small and we can use this more easily in our calculation. So let's remember now, how do we calculate the density of CO2? Density of CO2 is just the partial pressure of CO2 times the molecular mass of CO2 divided by R times the Kelvin temperature. Oh, but we don't have a temperature. Well, let's just assume a temperature. It's going to be pretty close. Let's assume the Kelvin temperature is equal to 293 Kelvin or 20 degrees Celsius. That makes things easier for us. Now we just have to put the numbers in the equation. So our 42.6 pascals times the molecular weight of CO2, 44 grams per mole, divided by the universal gas constant, 8.31 joules per mole Kelvin, times 293 Kelvin. Okay. Put parentheses around all those guys to make sure that we multiply them out right. If we plug that into our calculator and we cancel all the units, a pascal is equal to newton per meter squared. A joule is equal to a newton meter. That's going to help you doing your canceling. Once you put that all that in there, the density of CO2 is about 0.77 grams per meter cubed. So we're still not there yet. What's the mass? Well, a key piece was given in this problem right here, a meter cube of air. That's also making it easy. So if we have a density of 0.77 grams per meter cube and a volume of 1 meter cubed, 0.77 grams per meter cubed times a volume of 1 meter cubed, those things cancel right there, and we get 0.77 grams. Now, this is pretty important in certain calculations when we're trying to understand the mass movement. If we have partial pressures or if we have moles, we've got to be able to adjust. And this is one of the ways to move from a partial pressure to a mass. So again, why were we doing this? Well, we had a partial pressure of CO2 and we were interested in figuring out how much mass was in 1 meter cube of volume of that partial pressure of CO2. And it turns out a pretty small number. Now, why would we want to do that with CO2? I'm not sure. Sometimes we need to answer a question that way. Usually I'm trying to address problems of water vapor movement and it ends up being a pretty critical factor. So hopefully you understand how to get from a partial pressure now to an actual mass through the ideal gas law. For more content like this, check out our YouTube channel or head over to metergroup.com. See you next time on a Meter Chalk Talk.